Hello and welcome to today's episode of the International Daily Roundup by People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from around the world. Let's take a look at today's headlines. COVID-19 cases cross 9 million in Africa. Libyan parliamentary body says elections impossible. Indian gig workers launch strike against urban company. And Kellogg's cereal workers end 11-week strike in the United States. With the spread of the Omicron and Delta variants, COVID-19 cases across Africa have crossed 9.2 million as of December 22nd. However, experts have warned that the actual number of cases may be much higher. The WHO had stated in October that the real number of infections could be actually about 7 times higher. It added that the 2/3 of the deaths due to COVID has been underreported. The latest available data from the African Center for Disease Control places the death toll at over 226,000 people. Over 1/3 of all COVID cases in Africa have been detected in South Africa. This is followed by Morocco, Tunisia, Libya, and Ethiopia. Meanwhile, Nigeria, which has the continent's highest population, has recorded just over 225,000 cases so far. Health expert Dr. Ahmed Kalebi told People's Dispatch that this was because Nigeria has the lowest per capita testing rate in Africa. While infrastructure deficits have posed serious difficulties, experts stress that a systematic vaccination campaign will still be effective. As of now, only 8.6% of Africa's population has been fully vaccinated. A recent analysis has shown that at the current rate, the 70% vaccination target set by the WHO will not be reached before August 2024. Moreover, only 6 African countries will be able to reach the 40% minimum threshold set for the end of 2021. With rich countries now offering even a 4th dose, there are growing concerns of increased vaccine hoarding. Human rights groups have identified over 100 companies in Africa, Asia, and Latin America which have the potential to produce mRNA vaccines. However, rich countries have continued to block a patent waiver required to expand production. A parliamentary committee has declared that it is impossible to hold the key presidential elections scheduled for December 24th. The chairman of the body informed the head of parliament on December 22nd without providing a new date. This was a day after the High National Electoral Commission confirmed that it had ordered the dissolution of electoral committees nationwide. Despite the election being just days away, the commission had not published a final list of candidates. Over 100 nominations had been filed for the presidency, including incumbent Prime Minister Abdul Hamid Dabeiba and warlord Khalifa Haftar. Forces loyal to Haftar have also accused Prime Minister Dabeiba of violating last year's peace agreement. Dabeiba had promised at the time that no one from his government would contest the election. The election was a part of the UN political process to end 10 years of instability and conflict after the 2011 NATO-led invasion. An interim administration was set up in December 2020 to prepare Libya for general elections. Following a series of laws passed in September and October, the parliamentary elections were postponed to January 2022. Parliament Speaker and presidential contender Aguila Saleh was accused of issuing the laws without a proper vote. There have also been disputes over election rules and issues surrounding the impartiality of electoral institutions. While the ceasefire agreed upon in October 2020 is still holding, fear of violence between rival groups remain. Opposing armed groups had also gathered in Tripoli on Tuesday and blocked several roads. Moreover, foreign mercenaries and troops from countries like Turkey, Chad, and Russia are still in Libya despite demands for withdrawal. Despite these circumstances, countries like the United States and France are exerting immense pressure to hold elections. Next, we go to India to look at the ongoing struggle by gig workers against app-based home services provider Urban Company. On December 20th, over 100 women who worked as so-called partners in the company's spa and saloon verticals launched a strike at its office in Gurgaon. The protest was focused on policy changes introduced by Urban Company. The sit-in continued overnight and throughout Tuesday. However, Media agency N-Tracker reported on December 21st that Urban Company had filed a lawsuit against the protesting workers. In an injunction petition filed at the Gurugram District Court, it called the protesters' actions unlawful and illegal. Monday's protest focused on two new policies introduced by Urban Company. The first was a subscription system where workers would have to plan their monthly work calendar and take a minimum number of jobs. They would also have to pay a monthly fee of 2,000 to 3,000 rupees for a minimum guarantee plan. The second issue was the introduction of a category called Flexi. This would seek to penalize partners for not participating in the subscription system or for low response rates. Another issue raised was partners being asked to give customers a 10% discount from their own earnings. This week's strike followed just months after over 100 beauticians and spa workers walked out in October. Their demands included safe working conditions and social security benefits. Strikers also told N-Tracker that Urban Company was charging commissions as high as 35% from their earnings. The company had sent messages threatening police action to break the strike. And finally, we go to the United States, where workers at the Kellogg Food Company have ended their strike after 11 weeks. 1,400 workers across cereal plants in Michigan, Nebraska, Pennsylvania, and Tennessee had walked out on October 5th. They are members of the BCTGM union. They were protesting 16-hour shifts, 7-day working weeks, and a tiered wage and benefit system. 30% of workers across the four plants were subject to this system, under which new hires were given low wages and benefits. The striking workers overwhelmingly voted to reject the first tentative agreement on December 7th. Soon after this, Kellogg announced that it would permanently replace the striking workers. Despite these threats, the strike continued. BCTGM announced on December 21st that the workers had ratified a 5-year contract. The union said that the new deal did not contain any concession and had a clear path for full-time regular employment. The contract also guaranteed a moratorium on plant shutdowns till October 2026. It included a $1.10 per hour wage increase and cost of living adjustments. However, in terms of the tiered wage system, only workers with at least 4 years of experience will be able to move into a higher pay scale. And that's all for today's episode. For more such stories, visit our website at www.peoplesdispatch.org and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.